stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames the fire his servants. He set the earth on its foundation. It will never be moved. You cover it with the watery depths as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. Should we bow our head in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we realize that you have created everything that we see around us. We are just amazed at the power and the beauty of the things that you have created for us that we so often take for granted. We ask that you will help us to remember that you are how mighty and powerful you are, but yet you are kind and merciful and gracious to us all. And for this, we are very thankful. We ask that you will be with us now the rest of this day as we continue to worship you. Help us to remind us that we worship you not only on this day, but the entire week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, my God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, my husband Manasseh sends his greetings. He stayed back in Myanmar, but he wishes he could be here. Another thing is, we've been gone for 2 years. What did you guys do with Pastor Dave? He's gone. No, thankfully, due to technology, we were actually able to watch a little part of his retirement goodbye, so that was a real blessing. We just really appreciate you guys thinking of us and keeping us in your prayers, and we're really honored to be here this morning. Just a reminder, we serve in Myanmar, which is in Southeast Asia. It borders China, India, and then Thailand. And this is my family. This is Levi, and he is now 5. And this is Bati, she is now 10. We do homeschooling. The situation there is that foreigners are not allowed to go to the local school. So the only option is the few international schools that are running, and they are very costly. So homeschooling has worked well for us, and we'll continue to do that for a little while. When we returned 2 years ago, Myanmar had gone through COVID, and it had also gone through a military coup. So already we were going into a country that not a lot of people like to go to, but now things have changed again, and it's another different country. And so we are very fortunate to live in one of the safest areas of the country called Yangon, which is the largest city. And so if you go to Yangon, you'll see people going about their daily lives, going to school, going to work, going to the coffee shop, the tea shop. But when you start to talk to people, there's this undercurrent of what's going on in their situation. So they've got family members whose houses or businesses have burned in the villages around Myanmar. They've got other people who have had to flee the country. And so you really start to see the toll that it's taken on people. This is the first year that we've experienced some compassion fatigue. And so it's nothing major, but it just shows us that we're in the right place at the right time. And we're very fortunate to be walking alongside the people as they go through what they go through. We made a little bit of a video to give you an overview of some of the things that have been happening. We have to be more careful now about social media. And so if you do have us on Facebook or anything like that, you'll see that we don't often put things about our ministry or about the country situation. So it's oftentimes just things about our family or it's positive adventures that we have. But that doesn't mean that things are not still happening. The video we made, we didn't show the worst of the worst or the worst stories. But even after we left to come here, our coworker who leads our training team, his uncle's business and house were burned to the ground in one of the villages up north. And he and his wife were beaten, and they came back to Yangon to be in a safe place. So it was just kind of a reminder to us that the reality is still there. It may not be on media around the world, but the war is still going on. The government is still trying to control and taking its lessons from China. So now it's starting to firewall the VPNs, and if that happens, that will change our world, not having access to internet the way that it used to. But again, we're very fortunate. We live in a very safe place. Bati's got some great neighborhood friends. And so we feel like we're going to stay there until they kick us out or they revoke our visa. We do have a backup plan in case we need to escape. We'll head over to Thailand and wait it out. And so we do appreciate your prayers, not only for us, but the people that we're working with, the country, the government situation. And we're just going to show you a clip of some of the people that we've been working with. Also, in the back, we have refilled your prayer card with our new prayer cards. So feel free to take one, put it on your fridge, and we've got a couple of brochures for you as well. Okay, wait one moment. And that's a reminder, we work primarily with deaf people, and so you're going to see some of that on the video as well. Also, we wanted to bring a little bit of Southeast Asia back to you, and so we have some little candies in the back. If you've ever heard of durian, you probably have not had a very good example of it. So durian is very, very strong smelling, but it is sweet. So we brought some durian candy and also mangosteen. We brought some mangosteen candy and a few mango candies. So feel free to try that out and get a taste of Southeast Asia. We'll be here for a few minutes after the service if you want to chat. And we're going to show the video now. Mm-hmm.
That's a good question.
are watching live. The video can go out on Facebook. We've been careful even making the video, so you won't see names of people or locations or things like that. So it should be fine, but thanks for asking.
Apologize that we haven't been able to send out as many update videos as we would have liked, but we're being quite careful about social media right now because of the situation in Myanmar, which I'll talk a little bit later. Right now, I want to give you a little bit of an overview about some of the things our family has been up to lately in Myanmar. When we arrived 2 years ago, we realized that we were entering a different kind of country than what we left. They had been through COVID. They had been through a change in government. They now had more difficulties than ever before with the poverty level rising, gas prices rising, and different things that were going on. So our goal was simply to walk alongside the people. But we were surprised when we got there how many opportunities there were still to do our ministry. For example, we were able to run some incredible trainings the last couple of years. One of them is with our hearing YWAM, and we ran what's called a discipleship training school. This is a 3-month program of lectures followed by a 2-month program of doing outreach. I was so excited to be part of the team that helped the staff and did some staff training. And then we were more excited about sending these students out into all of Myanmar to preach the gospel and tell people about the hope that they can find in God. Manasseh also had the opportunity to teach in a few schools, and we were able to help with our local deaf church by also running a Bible training. One of our values is to train the upcoming generation to take on some leadership roles and to pioneer new things. YWAM is all about pioneering new things and encouraging the young people. And so that's one thing that we've been focusing on, especially this past year as well, providing opportunities for the young people to get new trainings, new ideas, new opportunities. And the best way to do that is through relationship. We've spent more time at the YWAM base than we normally do because we want to continue to create relationships that encourage the people that are doing the ministry full time and who are actually going out there and being the hands and feet of Jesus. Another thing that we have been continuing to focus on is encouraging our deaf people. As you can imagine, they have also really felt the change in government and the pressure that comes along with that. The good news is that we have seen an increase in attendance at our deaf church. We also have been able to see our friend, Pastor 99 Joe, become the head pastor instead of the assistant pastor. And as far as we know, it's the first time in Myanmar that a fully deaf person has been head pastor of a church. We have been so encouraged by him and are looking forward to seeing him continue to reach out to the people, including some evangelism trips, meeting people in their homes since they are not able to travel to the church. We also continue to run our cross-home children. We have increased how many children we have up to 13 at a time because of the country situation. We have started to get a few calls from some of the more war-torn areas asking us to be able to help their deaf children attend education or even just be in a safe place. I can't say enough about how proud we are of the patience and the perseverance of our co-worker Boynu and Nainai. They have continued to work with the children 24 hours a day, making sure that they are getting tutoring and Bible studies, and also teaching them life skills, how to make soap, how to wash their own clothes, how to cook. So encouraged by them. Something else that's new for our Deaf Strong Hands ministry is that we are combining with something called Deaf World, which is a YWAM ministry specifically geared at connecting the YWAMs around the world that are working with the deaf. We've been able to meet people in South Africa, in Jamaica, in Brazil, in Thailand, who also have a heart for the non-hearing communities. And so we were encouraged to connect with them and just create ideas about the future. One of the things that have come out of this is that 2 missionaries who are fully deaf came to Myanmar and spent a month with us. It was so nice to have them at our YWAM gathering, where our YWAM culture could experience what it's like to be fully deaf and be a missionary and worship alongside the hearing. We are also able to connect them with our churches so that they could be an encouragement by sharing their testimonies. They were also able to help us at our children's home. We were so encouraged by this, and we want to continue these relationships having missionaries sent here, and also training our deaf people to have missionaries sent out there. So we are so thankful for the partnership with Deaf World YWAM. For the last couple years, we've been sharing with you about needing a training center for our deaf community, one where we can host our seminars, our Bible studies, but also open it to the community. We've been doing some fundraising, and this year we have enough to be able to put down some rent. So we expect in the next 3 months to be able to open our office for our training. We will have a training room as well as an office space, since right now Manasseh's office has been at our house. And hopefully we also have a vision to have a kids room, which would include a library, lots of crafts, lots of hands-on play for the deaf children. Please continue to pray with us as we continue to fundraise for this and look for the right location. We've mentioned that one of our highest responsibilities that we feel during this time is walking alongside the people of Myanmar. Also, we've found that we've had more opportunities to meet immediate needs. I want to give you an example of one of the little girls who came to our cross home. Her name is Julie Pang, and we got a call in the middle of the night from her family who lives in Sangayang Division. They were going through a really hot spot of the war, and during that time they had to escape from their house and village and were living in a jungle forest area. Julie Pang also has other siblings that are hearing, and the parents were beginning to fear for their safety because as a deaf person, she was unable to realize how loud she was. Often she would make screeching noises or banging noises, and the family was feeling like it was putting the entire family in danger. So they asked if they could send her to Yangon to be safe. Of course, we accepted, and she came. It was the first time for her to experience other deaf people and to also experience how to learn sign language. When she went to school, however, her teachers were very frustrated with her. She didn't know how to sit still or act in a classroom, and to get attention, she would scream or even hit the teachers. This meant that they asked Boy Nua Nai Nai to take her out of school, so she spent 6 months unable to go to school. During this time, Boy Nu and Nai Nai taught her more sign language and also how to behave properly. She has grown so much, it's almost like she's a different girl. With the change in government and the things still going on in Myanmar, we want you to be assured that in Yangon, we are still very safe. It is one of the safest areas to be, and we don't have any fears. Also, we are so blessed with the location of our apartment. It is inside a bit of a gated community with guards. We also have elevator keys, and we're so thankful that our daughter and son have made excellent friends in the area as well. We have things within walking distance, and so if we need to stay in our little bubble, we can. Otherwise, we have easy access to the main roads that lead us to our ministry locations. Because of the situation, we are also much more careful about how much information we put out. The only reason is because we don't want our visa to in any way come to attention in front of the government officials. So you may notice on our social medias that we often talk about our family, or outings, or things like that, and we don't put as many ministry pictures as we used to. This is not because we are not busy and that things are not happening. It is simply that we are being more careful than we used to. Having said that, we wanted to put a little montage of pictures together to show you visually some of the things that are going on in Myanmar at first, but also some of the great things that God is doing, not only in our YWAM, but the other YWAMs across the nation.
Prayer requests this morning. One we should remember Yes, Tate.
Remember Nathan McVeigh in this situation.
Okay, continue to keep Nathan in our prayers. Any others? Okay, our hymn of prayer is Faith of Our Fathers. Be able to stand if you'll stand as we sing. Of the importance that fathers play in the life of not only the family but the community.
Also, Lord, we acknowledge that there's not always good fathers around. Some people grow up in the homes that
have fathers that aren't very kind. But yet we know that you are a good father, that you are kind and gracious to us. For those who have struggled with their father figure in their life, may we point them to you, the God of heaven, the Father of all, who loves all, who is one that's not mean or nasty, but one who loves unconditionally. Thank you for the report that we've heard. Lord, it is true that we often concentrate on countries where we see more war, but we know that all around, not only are people struggling, but people are trying to share the gospels in the world that is torn by turmoil and war. And Lord, we're grateful for those who are willing to go to follow the Great Commission and to share the good news of our Father in heaven. So thank you for the report we received this morning. May we pray for those all around who serve you. And Lord, we're grateful for this time together that we come and we bring our prayer requests and we keep Nathan in our prayers and others that might not have been spoken out loud, knowing that as a father, you care so deeply for each and every individual. And may we be a light to these people and show them your goodness and your kindness to them. And Lord, as we continue in our service, we want to honor you with our hearts open, that we might hear your word preached today and grow closer to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Juicy fruit. Anyone still have their gum? See, some of you. We handed out those packets of juicy fruit. We still have ours, so. But anyway, let's do our scripture this morning. The fruit of the Spirit, okay? We can say it together because we ought to know without the screen, right? Yeah. But we'll do it with the screen, all right? Okay, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Hey, you did well, didn't you? You know, one of the things that has amazed me from the time as I've gone through life and my aging process is the quest for a good cup of coffee, right? Coffee used to be just coffee. Nothing fancy about it. You went to the store and you look on the shelf and you kind of had a choice, Folgers or Maxwell House, right? But your choices were limited. I remember Mom and Dad having the percolator pot that sit on the stove. And then eventually they came out with the plug-in kind, and they kind of thought that was pretty special. And I remember how Mom was really kind of thrilled when Mr. Coffee came along, right? And now we have espresso machines, and if someone gave me an espresso machine and told me to make a good cup of coffee, I'd go, gotta look it up on YouTube. And does anyone here roast their coffee beans? My kids, some of our kids do, you know. Or they buy them already roasted and they grind them and they want to make sure that their coffee is perfect. And they certainly would not be happy with my Folgers coffee. So when they come to our house, they always try to find coffee somewhere else, okay? But I'm a Folgers kind of guy. So when I go to Starbucks with the kids and they all go to Starbucks and we walk in there and I look at the menu and it's like, and sometimes they go, I just take what they take. I don't want to look too dumb. Yep. But now I've learned if there's something, was it venti or something like that? I don't know, but now I order that, just plain coffee. But I'm sure that there are times in our lives when we've gone on that quest for something good, and maybe we've had that good cup of coffee that's just kind of unusual, and we might turn to someone who's like, man, that's just a good cup of coffee. It just hit the spot. Because we're drawn to goodness. I mean, we're drawn to a good cup of coffee, a good movie, good children, good companionship, good friends. And if you like stock car racing, there's a big race in Newton where I used to be the chaplain. And looking at this big race this weekend today, the cup race is there for the first time. And if you're a NASCAR fan, you're drawn to the good drivers. You kind of have your favorite driver. And if you like music, you're drawn to a good singer or instrumentalist. And you kind of follow them and you play their music. If you like cookies, there's nothing like a good Oreo. You know, man. And if we enjoy being around good people, eating good food, and hearing, sometimes we might hear a good sermon, and sometimes we just might find it hard to explain why we think this is so good. It's good to us, but we're kind of trying to, how do we explain this to somebody? And as I work through my sermon this week, I'm reminded about how much the Bible is devoted to praising God for his goodness. Verse after verse, page after page, speaks directly or indirectly of the goodness of God. In fact, we heard on the music before church today, if you were in here, like three of us were in here, but the Good, Good Father song by Chris Tomlin. He's a good, good father. And the book of Psalms is just loaded with that, with verses about God's goodness. And one of my favorite chapters is chapter 104 that Larry read about God setting the foundations of the earth. And then he goes on and he says, you rebuke the waters and they fled at the sound of your thunder. They took flight. They flowed over the mountains and they went down into the valleys to the place where you assigned them. You set a boundary they cannot see. Never again will they cover the earth. And then he goes on, he says, you make the stream pour waters into the ravine. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys come and quench their thirst. The birds of the air nest by the waters. We used to go down to Red Rock and watch the eagles there flying along the waters. And they sing from the branches. He waters mountains from his upper chambers. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for cattle and plants for man to cultivate. He brings forth food from the earth, wine that gladdens the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread that sustains his heart. And the moon marks off the season. The sun knows where to go down, and you bring darkness, and it becomes night, and all the beasts of the fields prowl. And a man goes out to his work, his labor until evening. How many are your works, O Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of creatures, your creatures. The sea is vast, spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things both big and small. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He looks at the earth and it trembles. He touches the mountains and they smoke. And I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him. God's goodness. God's goodness. And one of the first prayers we memorize is, God is good. No, I didn't. Yeah, God is great. God is good, right? And we thank him for the food. Amen. And many of the hymns and praise songs we have to do with the goodness of God. And there's a saying that churches say, God is good all the time.
Amen.
They don't know that one. God is good all the time, the congregation says.
All the time.
All the time, God is good.
Okay, thank you, Mary.
God is good all the time.
All the time, God is good.
There you go. If I say all the time, God is good.
God is good all the time.
All right, got that one down. Woo. But God is good all the time. And we can say that even when things are tough, can't we? Romans 8:28 says, you know, God is good even in those times that we struggle. To make good out of any situation. So good. And I think that's vital for our Christian life. That God is good all the time. And he's good to me. And it's out of God's goodness that we find salvation. In all the goodness that you possess, any ounce of goodness that you have comes from God. And that brings us to the fruit of the Spirit, the flavor of goodness. You know, we started with love, and that's pretty easy to understand love, agape love, unconditional love. Lee preached on patience, and we can relate to that because we all need a little bit of that. The same thing is true with peace. We want peace in the world when we see war and things. And then kindness, being motivated to be kind to all people. The fruit of the Spirit is goodness. And it's so closely related to kindness, I could have put them together, but kind people aren't always good. There's a story in the Des Moines Register this week that I read about a guy that was very kind to people. He helped mow their yard, he took care of them and all those kind of things, and he talked them into investing in his investment company, but he never invested the money. And now he's caught for embezzling and cheating people. He was kind to people, but he certainly, we would not say, is a good person. Because kindness is action. Goodness is the essence of who we are. Good people. And sometimes we can't explain why something is good. We just know it because we've tasted it. Psalm 34:8 says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Isn't that great? Have you ever had told someone that, or someone tell you that something tasted good and you never tried it? And they give it to you and it looks so good, it looks good on the outside, and your mouth begins to water, and then you taste it, and you try to swallow it, so you don't want to. You ever been there? I've been there. And I can stand up here and I can tell you about God's goodness, but until you really taste it, will you really know how good God is? It's kind of like the baking shows on TV, you know. They decorate those cakes and they look so good. But the real test is to taste it. That's where it is. So we're going to look at God's goodness. We're going to look at a couple parts of that, but God is a source of goodness. In our lives, God is the source, and that comes from the Spirit. And if we focus on God's goodness, then it helps us to understand goodness as a fruit of the Spirit, as one of the flavors. And in many places we see God's goodness, I'm going to share two of them with you, okay? Because we do want to go home today, okay? We see God's goodness in creation, don't we? God could have made our earth bland. You ever think about that? What if God made all of our food to taste like tuna? He could have. I had a friend in college, we'd go to Dairy Queen in Huron, South Dakota, the Bible College does that. And we'd drive out there and Rich would order a tuna malt. He actually ordered a tuna malt and they'd look at him and go, what? Yeah. I hate tuna. I don't like seafood. And I praise God that Oreos don't taste like tuna. Right? I do. And I'm thankful that I have 10,000 taste buds in my mouth that get replenished every 2 weeks. Did you know that? And what if God would have made our world black and white? And these beautiful windows that we have would just be black and white. And the world would be black and white. And what would it be like if God didn't give us a solar system to look at and to explore and those telescopes to look way out and see the beauty of his creation? What if we didn't have that? You ever been to the Grand Canyon? Stood on the rim of the Grand Canyon? Have you ever been on top of a mountain and looked out over the valley? Or sit on the ocean and just watch as all the waves just come and splash up on shore? Or laid out on a hillside and looked up at the galaxy and the mountains? In Arizona, it's so clear. Or look at the clouds as they go through the sky and pass by. Have you ever seen a sunset or a sunrise? God didn't have to do that. He didn't have to do that. He didn't have to make his creation beautiful. And are you ever amazed that God created each and every one of us? He knew us in our mother's womb. Have you ever been amazed at that? And that all people that have ever been born on this earth, there's never was or never will be one exactly like you. So turn to the person next to you and say, I'm sure glad there's never going to be another one of you. Now you don't have to do that. But there isn't. There isn't ever going to be someone exactly like you. And I read through Psalm 104 and it's just highlighted of God's goodness in creation. And then I think that you are the crowning of God's creation. Of all the beauty that we see, the thing that God said is the best is you. Because when he created things in the first days of creation, he said, that's good. But when he created man, he goes, man, that's very good. And when he gave Adam to Eve, took a rib and made Eve and said, here, Adam, here's a woman, Adam, here's your wife. And he goes, whoa, man, you know. It was very good. Very good. And listen, when I see you at your very worst, I see the best of God's creation. And I see goodness in spite of your worstness. Is that a word, worstness? But you are the very best of God's creation, the crowning of his glory. God is good all the time.
All the time, God is good.
I know I had to wake you up. I know what I'm saying. God is good. And the second way that God shows his goodness is in the life of his son, Jesus. Isn't it? Just the thought that Jesus would come to this earth, come down here to save us, shows the extreme goodness of God. He left heaven where we want to go, right? To come here, I want to get there. I'm almost ready to check out, you know? It'd be good to go. And when Jesus walked on this earth, he was so good to all kinds of people. Good to the sinners and to the tax collectors and to the prostitutes and to the Samaritans, but also to some of the religious leaders. It was his goodness that just drew people to him. They flocked to him because he was good. And we read about how good he was to his disciples, even though his disciples bickered and fought and even betrayed him. He called him friends on the night that he knew they were going to leave him and abandon him. He called him friends. And he loved them and he prayed for them and he poured his life into them. He was even good to those who crucified him. He was up on the cross and he looked down at those who drove those nails through his hands and his feet and the spear in his side and whipped him and beat him. And he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. God's goodness is no more evident in the cross. And for God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. That's goodness. That's why we have missionaries to go with the gospel message. That's why we get up every morning and we live, because God is so good. He sent his Son not into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. That's goodness. So look at the cross. If anything else, look at the cross and know that God is good. And taste and see that God is good according to Psalm. One of my favorite times in church service is when we can have communion. Because it is a time that we think about the cross and we think about the crucifixion, but we actually pick up the elements that Jesus left. When he said, this is my body that has been broken for you. We get a taste of it. And then he said, this is my blood which is shed for you. And we get to taste it. It doesn't become blood. And it reminds us that that all comes about by the goodness of God. And God is good and calls us to be good like him. When our kids are small, we constantly remind them, you be good. You know? You be nice. I raised three boys. You have to tell them that all the time. You know, don't hit one another. You got to be good. And hopefully they grow into their teen years and into adulthood, because when we look at our children and they're good, we go, what a blessing it is. I did something right, you know, somewhere along the line. So if the fruit of the Spirit that resides in us is goodness, how can we live that out? How do I water and nurture that fruit so that it grows into the goodness? Because God is good and the earth is full of his goodness, and I'm part of that creation. And God's Holy Spirit is good, and it is there to do good through you. It becomes an essence of who you are. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't see myself as good. I can be like the Apostle Paul, who struggled with that, the great Apostle Paul. In Romans 5, he says, I know nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature. For I have a desire to do good, but I cannot carry it out. You ever feel that way? And that's why the Holy Spirit is so important in our life, because the Holy Spirit trumps that sinful nature that we have. Because we do have that. And there's a battle. So in that scripture, when we talk about where Paul writes, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, just before that, this is what he says. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so you do not do what you want. See, we realize that one reason God gives us the Spirit of goodness, the Holy Spirit in our life, is to battle that sinful nature that we have because Adam sinned in the garden. Blame him, but we still sin. So I need that Holy Spirit in me. And as a Christian, I can say I am good because God's goodness has been planted in me. I may not show it all the time, but I live in a new life. I become a new creation. And the fruit of the Spirit is growing in my life every day. It hasn't fully matured, but his goodness will grow in power and beauty, and it changes who I am on a daily basis. And I'm not good because my mommy's good. Mom said, you be a good boy, Marky boy. That's what they call me. That's not why I'm good. I'm not good because I'm a preacher, and I get paid to be good, I guess you might say. I'm good because God is in me through the Holy Spirit. And his goodness is in me. It goes beyond being kind. It is the essence of goodness that we taste in our lives. I like this verse from Galatians 6, 9 through 10. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we don't give up. Sometimes it's easy to give up. Therefore, as we have an opportunity to do good, let us do good to all people, especially to those of the household of faith. I love that verse because we're called to be good to all people. Number one, different races, different religions, different social groups, people that might have different morals than we do. But just as God is good to all people, we need to show goodness. But I like when he says this, that it was supposed to be especially good to the household of faith. Wow. That's you. That's fellow believers. And so many people will say, I don't need the church. How can you be good to the household of faith if you're not part of a church? And I'm here to tell you, and I didn't think about this until I was eating my bowl of cereal this morning. I'm sitting there eating cereal, and I was just thinking, and I thought, I can think of times in my ministry where it was God's household of faith that was good to me, that got me through the times when my son had cancer, that got me through divorce, that got me through when I doubted and got me through when I was struggling. The goodness of God's people and God's family. And we are called to be good to all people, but especially the people sitting in these pews today. Don't throw them under the bus. Sometimes the church is good at that. Don't abandon someone who's struggling. That's the time for us to just step up to the plate and to show the goodness of God who lives in us through the Holy Spirit. It's there because it's the flavor of the Holy Spirit. I have a song that is pretty popular on the radio, and you don't want me to sing it, so I'm going to read the words to it. It's called The Goodness of God, and we sing it in our churches in Arizona when we're down there in the winter. But it just says so much. It says, I love you, Lord, for your mercy never failed me. All my days I've been held in your hands, even in the womb. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the mercy of God. Goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I'm able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you've been so, so good. And with every breath that I am able, man, I'm going to sing of the goodness of God. And the bridge goes, your goodness is running, it's running after me. It's running after me. And I will sing of the goodness of God. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. Amen?
Amen.
God is good?
All the time God is good.
All the time God is good. We're going to sing, God is so good. Let's stand and listen.
Thank you.
Don't forget, God is so good. This time we will receive our offering. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious and loving Father, thank you for your goodness to us, seen in creation, but displayed so vividly and in color with your Son Jesus as he went to the cross for us. And in response to your goodness, Lord, we come in here this morning, and we come with joy as we give our offerings to you. We not only want to support our church family, but we want to support our community. We certainly want to support the missionaries that are out there going where we don't go and sharing the goodness of God. We know you love a cheerful giver, Lord, so we pray we might give cheerfully to you and love you with all of our hearts. We pray this in Jesus' name.
First off, I'd like to thank Liz for coming and sharing with us today. I'm glad we're here in the States. And we will keep praying for you over there. And Manassas, give him our best when you see him. And God is good. Amen. And we are going to have a quick search committee meeting up at the front of the sanctuary afterwards. Other than that, all you fathers, have a happy Father's Day, and we will see you next week.
Dick, woo, now I'm on. I was unplugged. So there. Our benediction is from that text we used at the end of the sermon, Galatians 6, 9 to 10. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have an opportunity to do good, let us do good for all people, especially to the household of faith. Go and be good today, this week, okay? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. When we all get to heaven.
Amen.